And thank you so much for attending our session. I know there is a ton of choices you have here with the rich content that RSA Conference is providing, but hopefully you'll find this a worthwhile investment of your time. No promises, but we'll try our level best to give you good tips as we go through the session. I'm Reeny Sondhi, and I lead the product security team at Autodesk. Tony Arous, as we covered in the introduction, he's the head of application security, working for the same team at Autodesk. And it's a two-speaker presentation. So the way we are going to do this is I will start the presentation. I'll set up some of our objectives and give you some background. Tony will take us through a large part of the meat of the presentation with more focus on implementation details that we want to share with you. And then we'll do a little bit of wrap up and obviously go through Q&A at the end. So in terms of what we want to cover, so I do want to kind of give you a little bit of a background of Tony and I. So we have an interesting history of having worked in product security for the last 10 plus years now, Tony. And we were involved in bootstrapping the product security initiative, the program at EMC, which is now Dell EMC, the parent company of RSA. I joined Autodesk sometime around the middle of 2015. And Tony recently joined Autodesk as well. And what we've been doing in the company in terms of product security is there's been a transformation that the company itself, Autodesk itself, has been going through, and which has led us, and I'll talk a little bit more in detail about what that transformation is, but that transformation has led us to rethinking the way we do product security in the company. There's a little bit of a slight paradigm shift in terms of product security, which we want to cover with you today. Today's presentation, when we talk about redefining product security, what we are really doing is giving you a case study of how we do product security at Autodesk. It's not a debate about looking at this domain and sort of calling it something other than product security, or people throw terms around such as DevSecOps and SecDevOps and the flavor du jour. So my and Tony's intention is not to come here and get into a debate about the domain itself, but it's really our view of how we are trying to do product security in the company that we want to present to you. As we go through this, we want to show and share with you certain lessons that we have learned and mistakes that we have made, pitfalls that we will talk about as well, some things that have worked really well for us. So hopefully at the end of the presentation, you will have enough to take with you if you're here to learn some tips from us. Hopefully we will give you enough of that as you go back and back into your jobs again. So I want to talk a little bit about Autodesk at this point. So before I show you my slide on Autodesk, I want to do a quick poll in the room of how many of you know Autodesk as a company? With a show of hands. Okay, perfect. How many of you know us as the company behind AutoCAD? All right. How many of you know us as the company whose technology is behind the last 20 years of Academy Award winning movies for visual effects? Ah, there we go. This is what I expected. So this is exactly how, when I came to know about Autodesk, my reaction to Autodesk when they came calling and they said, hey, we have a job for you. My reaction to them was, well, you do AutoCAD. What am I really going to come in and do for you? From a product security perspective, it's a one product company. And they basically said, come down, talk to us, and we'll tell you who we are. And really what we realized, and both Tony and I have had the same experience, is that we realized that Autodesk is a much more than AutoCAD. Our view or our vision internally, which I'm trying to come here and share with you, when we talk about our company internally, inside the company, we basically say that if we look at the world around us, if God hasn't created something, Autodesk has had a role has played a role in creating it. And for the atheists in the room, I'm sorry for having used the reference to God, but really what we are trying to do is when you think of Google and when you think of searching for something, you go to Google. When you think of buying something, you go to Amazon. That's pretty much the reality today. And if you think of our, you know, who our customers are, when they think of designing something or making something, they go to Autodesk. The company has been going through a transformation from our business model, where we were traditionally a desktop product company. And over the course of the last 4 years or so, we've been moving the direction of making all our products available as cloud-based services. We no longer sell perpetual licenses on our products. Everything is subscription-based, and we are moving more and more in the direction of opening up our platform, opening up our APIs, where people can actually come in and build and design and make things as they feel free. So you will find Autodesk as the company that actually does the next generation electric vehicle of the future, or you will find someone sitting in their home office, a jewelry designer trying to sell their latest jewelry collection on Etsy. They will come and use Autodesk as the platform for doing that. So speaking of the transformation as well as what kind of a company we are, so we have about 150 plus products at this point. We've acquired a bunch of companies in the past. And I would say that overall, from our products perspective, products have every and any flavor of development language that you can think of that they are developed in. They run on any and every flavor of platform that you can think about. So that's pretty much the Autodesk of the last 3 to 4 years and where things are. And a total of about 10,000 people in the company, 3 to 4,000 of them are focused on engineering and product development. And if you are in town and you want to stop by and see how our customers actually use our products, we have a gallery, which is like a museum on One Market, very close to the Ferry Building. Take some time, the sessions get boring sometimes. Come over, have a look at what our customers are doing and how they are actually using our products. So now, talking about the transformation piece. So I mentioned the transformation to the cloud and making our products available as SaaS services or even, PaaS services to our customers. So along with the transformation, what has happened is it's not just the business model that is transforming for us, but it is also the product development model that has been going through a major transformation at Autodesk in the last 3 to 4 years. So we've been a company where, innovation was fueled. Everybody was, when we were acquiring companies and we were acquiring products to come into the fold, we would go out and say, there is no heavy-handed sort of corporate processes we are going to go and force down the throats of people who are joining the company. But over the course of the transformation that I'm talking about that we have been going through, we've realized that when we talk about building for the cloud, things are different. You can no longer have your own way of building things and every flavor of every application that we are trying to bring to the cloud can be built on their own little flavor. So what we've been doing is we have come to the realization that we are no longer a company that is in the business of just building and shipping products, but we are actually in the business of running our own products. So now I talk about product security, which has been a slightly young initiative in the company. We've been around for about 4 years. Our role at Autodesk is not just about helping our development teams in using best practices throughout the development lifecycle. So, doing threat modeling and running static analysis tools and doing security testing, et cetera. But the role of my team or role of product security at Autodesk is also about running these products securely in the cloud. So some of the benefits and challenges that come along with this are, let me talk about a couple of them there. One is because we are running our own products, we get real-time feedback of the security or lack thereof within our products or applications that we are running in the cloud. So what that does for us is also if we know there are certain security weaknesses, we are able to put some sort of compensating controls in making sure that we get some breathing room on the application security side to take care of those weaknesses, right? So overall, the message that I want to kind of leave you with on this slide is, too busy a slide, I don't want to kind of get into the slide here, but really for us, product security, the way we have been thinking about product security is it doesn't really end at the point that we build a product and we, you know, because we are really not shipping it, it goes to the end-to-end life cycle of building as well as running the product. The other piece that I'm going to, you know, also leave you with is we call it product security as a discipline in the organization. That is because our cloud and the products in the cloud are run by our product organization. It's not run by a separate IT or EIS organization. It's really the product organization that's running the cloud. The other piece that I do want to call out also is, from a product security perspective, is the term product security. People come to me many times and say, hey, isn't this application security? Isn't this software security? And in our case, it's actually not. It's actually, we like using the term product security internally at Autodesk because it's the end-to-end life cycle of building, deploying, and running our products. In terms of the strategy on which we have built our security practices, we are a firm believer in the fact that there is enough outside out there in the industry that we can borrow from, so that we don't have to go and think of ourselves as a unique snowflake and say, hey, all the good practices that are out there, we really don't care about it, we're gonna build our own. No, the way we are building our strategy is we are not reinventing the wheel. So we have gone and looked at certain set of standards and borrowed very heavily from them. You will not see everything up here. As an example, when I look at the slide, I don't see things such as OWASP as an example, but we've looked at SafeCode, we've looked at BSIM, we've looked at OWASP top 10, and used them in the application security side of the house. And then on the cloud security side of the house, we have borrowed heavily from the Cloud Security Alliance, CSA's CCM. We have standardized on ISO 27001 and SOC 2 as the audit standards for us, which we undergo every year on our applications and products in the cloud. And these I covered this a little bit in detail, but if you ask me a question about, you know, tell me exactly what are the pillars of product security in the company. So there's the application security side of the house, there is cloud security, and there's the compliance piece. All of this together make up our product security discipline in the company. And I'll leave it to Tony to kind of go into the details, but at the end of the day, just from an objective perspective, when a product security organization is asked what their real objective is, you know, why do they exist? In our case, the way we define that is the fact that we exist because we want to make sure that we minimize existence of security vulnerabilities and weaknesses in not just our products, but also in our infrastructure, and that we build repeatability and repeatable processes in the way we are actually going out and doing this in the company. And a lot of product security in the cloud is about integration into a corp, CI/CD, pipeline, et cetera. We'll cover a little bit of that here as well. But some of the advantages of the standardization approach that Autodesk has been trying to put in place and trying to take away some of the unique flavors problem that we had when we were acquiring companies has led us to do a lot of automation. You'll see some glimpses of how we are taking tools and automating that as part of our CI/CD pipeline. You'll see glimpses of, as we go through this, we will not just cover the piece around tools and integration of tools and automation, but we will also spend some time talking about how we actually roll out the program, how do we do dashboards, how do we do reporting and metrics. But at this point, I'm going to hand over to Tony to take you through the rest.
Thank you. Thank you, Reeny. So before we go too far, I just wanted to take a few moments and look at the old world, really, where we've come from, and give you a little bit of a glimpse into some challenges that we face and really the direction that we're going. We'll freely admit we're not all the way there yet, but we're making some good progress along that path. First off, as Reeny mentioned before, Autodesk with 150 plus different products, you can imagine that starting out we had many different tools. So if you just take source control, for example, I'm sure many organizations have dozens of different source control systems in place or different bug tracking systems. So the direction that we're moving towards is trying to consolidate into one, which makes everybody's job easier at the end of the day, both in terms of your developers, in creating the code, as well as security and making sure that they're writing secure code and being able to respond to any issues. The other aspect is really the kind of the lack of standardization, and then that really led to slow, ineffective results, which caused a bunch of ripple effects. First off, it becomes really challenging to report. When you have many different sources for this data, it's hard to track your progress. How do you compare the effectiveness of one tool versus another? And then really, at the end of the day, what it means is that you have a hard time identifying those risks and really where does your company fit or where does your product fit. So as we're looking forward and we're partway on this path is really focusing on a single tool per function where we can. There are certain cases where you need more than one. And then centralizing the operation. So we have a security-focused team that's responsible for operating these tools, know them inside and out, and work closely with the developers or with QA across the organization in order to be effective. So before I really drill into kind of CI, CD, and everything, I can give you a little bit of glimpse of why it's important and why it was important to us. First off, a lot of the companies that have been really born cloud native, if you've heard of it, they've been doing CI, CD from the beginning. But when you take a company like Autodesk or other larger companies that have been around for 20, 30 plus years, making that move can be challenging, but it's essential in order to keep pace in today's fast-moving world. So it helps you improve your efficiency, improve collaboration among developers, and really encourages reuse across engineering teams. The second aspect of this is to really build in that cadence for frequent delivery. So traditionally, I know Autodesk kind of on the desktop product side would be like many traditional companies, that it would take months or a year or even longer to release a new version of a product. These days, when a company is fully on board with CI/CD, you can do it weekly or daily or something. Some companies releasing many times per day to production. And what that really means is you need to have a tight integration of your products, your workflows, and all your processes. Thirdly, and I touch on this a little bit, is really encouraging collaboration among the developers and the different stakeholders, because it makes it easier to help out each other when that development environment is standardized. So as I touched on before, if you have one bug tracking system, everything can feed into that rather than dealing with discrete systems that you may or may not have visibility into. So what you heard me talking about CI/CD, but you may be asking, what is it? So let me ask all of you, who's heard of CI/CD before? Okay. Great. So
maybe you want to define it.
Yeah. Great. So you see, there's kind of a transition here. So a lot of companies, and some probably are still doing it, kind of a waterfall approach, kind of very regimented or structured, with upfront requirements and planning phases and development, and then you hand over to QA, you do some sanity checking before you ultimately release. The problem, obviously, with this is you end up with long, drawn-out cycles and everything. The second one, Agile, where a lot of people are calling Agile, or you may have heard the term water, scrum fall, is really focusing on that middle piece. You still have a lot of upfront requirements, but you're really just introducing sprints, let's say like 2-week sprints in the middle, and just iterating through some lightweight planning, some dev, and some test. But most companies, when you speak to them, will admit that at the end of every sprint, they're not ready to release. They still need to add in one or more stabilization sprints at the end just to make sure everything's okay. So, and that's really where that term came in. Then lastly, CI/CD, sometimes DevOps, DevSecOps, however you want to call it, is really focusing on taking that but being able to release at every single iteration. So whether you're a 2-week sprint or whatever your duration is, you can release frequently and bake your planning into the same process. So you'll see things that when you get so mature that you really have all your processes down, you'll be able to continually plan and just pick up the top of your backlog, and that's where you'll hear Kanban instead of scrums, because you'll be able to release more frequently than every sprint. So now taking a step deeper into Autodesk, as I touched on before, really big focus on standardization. So I won't drill into every single block here, But you'll see kind of across these themes, we have, so in our communication stack, standardized on one wiki for the entire company. So all the products are onboarded, are in there, and there's kind of free collaboration and communication. Same thing with chat. There's one Slack team for the entire company. Bug tracking, I've touched on a little bit now, but rather than dealing with one product that might be using Bugzilla, one that's using Jira, one that's using something else, the whole company is running on one instance. Same goes with our source control, with our build orchestration, and everything like that. And what you'll see across the bottom is there's several other services like localization and like security. So security isn't treated as a special process off to the side. It's really baked into this so that as part of your build orchestration, for example, you can get your static code analysis in there using a tool like Checkmarks or Fortify, or get your open source analysis, and everything bakes in there. And there's many other facets to it. One important note on all these different components is that each one that we've learned through some mistakes is that it's important to have clear owners and clear responsibilities for each one of them. When you get to that level of being able to have continuous integration, you need to make sure that all those services are available and up and running 24/7. Because you may have a developer checking in code at 2 in the morning Pacific time, and if Checkmarks is down, you can't expect the business to stop until somebody on US time comes in to bring it back online. So we do that really through making sure that you have those processes in place and the right people, but also encouraging that inner sourcing for collaboration in order, for example, sharing scripts for Jenkins and pipeline libraries and everything like that. So all that has really been focused on the CI side and really feeding into CD, kind of building automation into the promotion process. So for example, some of these tools we know can't run every commit or every build. They just take too long. So what we've done is really, and what we're aiming to do, is build some gates in at the promotion phase based on certain requirements. So for example, and I'll touch on this in a little bit, is that you may be doing static analysis, or incremental scans or lightweight scans on every build, but you'll do your deep, thorough scanning once a day or once a week, and that will gate a promotion to staging, for example. So just really zoning in a little bit on the security piece here, you'll see the same terms that we've talked about in terms of designing and developing and tests and everything. We've baked in security tools at each phase of that life cycle. So it's, again, not treated like anything special. So you'll have threat modeling, and I'll drill into each one of these in particular later on, but you'll have your tools that run at each point, and it becomes second nature to your developers. So now really taking each piece at a time. So starting out with threat modeling, and this tends to be an area that gets forgotten in this, because we all think of threat modeling as a very long process, comprehensive. It can take days or weeks or longer to create a true threat model. And it changes. You invest all that time, and then somebody goes and changes a design spec, and you have to go redo the threat model. We are trying to go in the direction more on the right. It's been a challenge, but there's still some work to do. But really, developers now are treating their code as their design. So we want to bake threat modeling into that process and go off of a standardized framework and really only have to threat model the changes to improve that capability. So in the next phase, really with build or static analysis, as I mentioned before, so you can leverage several different tools, but one of the key pieces here is to use automation to the best of your ability. So for example, you can put some standards in place regarding what your absolute requirements are. So for example, we'll focus on critical and high vulnerabilities for a few different select types, like maybe cross-site scripting or injection, things like that. And you really try to bake in that continuous real-time feedback into the process. So, and then lastly, kind of initially, and where we are right now, is on the alerting side, is that we'll run these scans and alert the developers of issues, but we're not at the point where we can fail the build just yet. But that's our goal, is that ultimately, a developer treats a security issue just like they're breaking the build. Nobody's going to open a pull request if their builds are failing, just like if they're introducing an injection possibility. And then the last piece of this is we know that there are cases where you need more deep or thorough analysis. And this is touches on what I mentioned earlier around serving as a gate potentially to run on a more routine basis, maybe nightly or weekly or so, and gating a promotion. Next on open source and third-party components, there's a lot of information. You know, you may have heard the metric that 80% of the code in enterprise applications now is open source code. So our view is really not to treat it any differently than the code that your developers are writing. So go through the same process. And then the other aspect of it is to make sure that you're doing those open source scans to detect vulnerabilities and notify the developers when they should be updating to a new version of it or potentially looking at an alternative solution. Moving to the next and the test phase, several different aspects of this, and this is one area where we'll admit there's some challenges, but if you start out kind of with dynamic analysis, this has been an area that generally the feeling has been that it doesn't play that well with CI/CD. So this is another one of those cases where you can look at it as running out of band on some other cadence rather than baking in. But there's also some opportunities when you kind of look at IaaS with interactive application testing around instrumenting the code and getting a little bit more automation in there. But obviously that has some other challenges to do because you're kind of baking it into the code. But it gives you the advantage of a lower false positive rate that's more traditionally known in the static analysis side. And then lastly, fuzzing, an area that really affects us closely because when we look at Autodesk products, all of our products are working with design files. So many of them proprietary formats or complicated schemas. So this is a key area for us that we're trying to work, really trying to invest in more. And really testing those files and to exercise these different conditions and identify injections and other things like that. And as well with our shift towards more cloud products is we're becoming an API-driven company. So we need a lot more fuzzing of the APIs. So now really kind of moving more onto kind of beyond the development, more in kind of the operation side. What we're doing is focusing or treating infrastructure. You really need to treat the infrastructure as code. So just like you track your build scripts or your source code or your test code in with your application, you really need to exercise the same capability with your infrastructure. So this means tracking your, so it gives you the capability to track your changes in the infrastructure and then be able to apply policies and apply patches more quickly. And then lastly, just looking at compliance, much along the same lines. So if you bake that in, you can leverage automation the same way to identify any cases where code or infrastructure changes are going in that may put you out of compliance. And it gives you really that true, all these things really give you that traceability and visibility and that audit trail to see when things have changed and when they've gotten better or worst case, when they've regressed. So I'll hand it back over.
All right, so Tony talked a lot about integration of tools, automation in our CI/CD pipeline. But one aspect of a good mature product security program that we have learned from our practice is that product security is not just about tools. So it's also about it's people, process, technology, all kind of blended together. So on our side, the focus on our side has been that we have not just integrated tools and the practices that Tony took us through, but also we are focused on rolling it out as a fully well-baked program that our product development teams, our management organization looks at as this is something which is extremely critical for us as we go out and build our products. So what we have done on that front is when we've been going to our development organizations and we've been going to our cloud ops, the DevOps side of the house, The question that we used to be asked all the time is that when it comes to security, we seem to be never be done. And that is true because it's a journey. It's not something that you can go out and say, hey, I'm going to run these X number of tools, fix all these vulnerabilities, and I'm good and I'm done with it. So what we have done is we have introduced the concept, from a program perspective, we have introduced the concept of security non-negotiables, which our development organization and our cloud production organization, cloud ops organization understands very well. We played, we gamified it a little bit. We have played the game of saying you have to do five things on the development side, and you have to do five things on the production side. Now, as you kind of dig deeper, there are many more than five things into each and every element of what we have here. But the intention is to, rather than having our product development teams, our engineering organization, swimming in the plethora of security requests and requirements that we throw on them, we have tried to bring it down to this rule of five. And what we want to do every year is, because we want to keep on increasing the maturity of our product security program within the company, so every year, the asks that we have in here keep on getting more and more stringent. But if you notice, the asks kind of go across the aspects of how will we go out and train our organization, our development organization. So we have one ask which is all about training. So as an example, one of the asks here is that 100% of our engineering and development focused personnel should undergo the security belt training program. We have kind of gone out and modeled it a lot on what Adobe has done as well, but we modeled it to more suit Autodesk culture. So we've gone out and created a training program which is belt-based and everybody must go through this. Now, we put down a goal of 100%. We ended last year at 98%. I think that's pretty good. That's pretty, you know, successful in terms of how we have rolled this out. On the other side, when it comes to actually going and fixing critical vulnerabilities and critical issues, what we've tried to do is we've tried to focus our teams on fixing P0 and P1. So these are the critical, the high-risk vulnerabilities that get thrown to us, either by threat modeling or by running static analysis tools, open source analysis tools, et cetera. And we've identified the classes of vulnerabilities that we want our product teams to focus on. And that's been done very deliberately because we know the types of products and applications we are running, and we are, you know, kind of making it them available to our customers. We know the specific classes of vulnerabilities they suffer from. So we want our engineers to first focus on fixing those rather than going out and trying to fix every possible vulnerability that they end up finding. On the production side, similar to what I mentioned, our focus is on patching, on hardening, securing identities and access. These are basic things, foundational elements that we critically believe that if we don't get these right, it is going to be very difficult for us to build our house of product security on a very weak foundation. So that's really the reason why we have this concept of non-negotiables. And the other piece that is, you know, fundamentally also very specific to us is as we call out these five specifics, five non-negotiables, we run dashboards and metrics and reporting around these five non-negotiables. So as an example, I'll show you, you know, certain dashboards. Obviously, I've, you know, anonymized all the names here. You recognize and realize why I would do that. But these are the kind of dashboards we create where we show each and every non-negotiable. We show how a product is going through an application that has gone through, as an example, a static analysis tool, and we've done a baseline and we found the world of vulnerabilities that may be in the baseline. What was the baseline and where are they today? If we go out and do a scan today and the real-time nature of CI/CD, we can go and figure out where they are today in terms of comparison to baseline. So that enables our teams to see whether they should laugh or they should cry when it comes to actually adopting these security non-negotiables that I talked about. So similar to that, we have a dashboard that we use for executive management reporting on the production side as well. So lastly, I'm going to, you know, because I know we're running short on time here. So a couple of slides. One is on our lessons learned on the transformation journey. So one piece that has been very clear to in our business model and product development transformation is that we have realized that the move towards standardization and having a standardized approach be it in the tools we use, be it in our one framework for CI/CD to push code to production. It's been very critical, and it's a lesson that we have learned after making many mistakes, and then finally realizing that this is the direction in which we absolutely must head. So standards and CI/CD, I kind of covered that. The fact that we need to have a central management of tools is being very critical as well. So, you know, this notion of anyone can run their own tools and every team can, you know, will make them the tools available to everybody and they're going to run it on their own, it's just not something that has worked very well for us. So we've moved in the direction of the centralization. And then one piece that we kind of forget is, and our engineering teams have reminded us many times, is dashboards are not boring. They are very critical to report status up and report status down. So in order for us to actually create an entire program around it, we absolutely believe that you need to be able to show people how successful they have been in adopting the program. And the other last piece on the culture piece is, because of the transformation journey that Autodesk has been on, we have a culture in the company where there's the desktop culture and then there's the cloud culture. But what we have realized is that, you know, you cannot really look at culture as a cop-out and say, hey, the desktop people are not going to understand how to do security and we are only going to focus on the cloud people. We have gone out and done our program across the board and we've taken the entire classes of, you know, people and cultures that we have in the organization. We have knocked down those silos from a security perspective because we believe fundamentally at the end of the day, people want to do the right thing. Engineers, when they think about security, they want to do all the right things. They need to know what to do and how to do. And last key takeaways, so as you go out and build, if you are thinking of building a program on your side, if you're here to learn something on how we have done this, obviously build a roadmap. Don't try and boil the ocean. Don't try and do things which are, you'll go out and you read about all these standards and you know, BSIM says there are 120 things that you must do and SafeCode says there are 50 or whatever. Don't boil the ocean. Think about what is the most critical things that you need to do for your own organization. It's very critical to focus on those first. Appoint security champions. The team that I have is always going to be a small, lean team from a security perspective. So the faster we can get product teams to take ownership and engineering teams to take ownership of security, the better it is going to be for us. So on our side, we have gone away from the model of just nominating security champions, but we have actually moved in the direction of actually providing accountability to these security champions for doing the right things from a security perspective. Spreading awareness, training is very critical. Not everything can be solved by training. So a lot of immature product security programs focus initially very heavily on training, which is good. But training is only, you know, people are going to only absorb. On our side, we realized that the absorption rate when we did quizzes after somebody's gone through training and gave them a few months and then gave them a quiz to go through, we realized that 60% of the people are failing the quizzes. So really, the absorption of what they have gone through training is going to be fundamentally more closer to them when they actually experience a certain issue, a security issue, as they develop the code. Tony, do you want to have the last few?
Sure. Yeah, so that's okay. So regarding the last couple, as I was talking about before, it's really important to inject those security tools into your entire development or CI/CD process, and don't treat them as something special. So if they're just like your build systems or your test systems, security will become part of that second nature for developers. Also, it's okay. I've told my team before, it's okay to fail. You can experiment with some things, start small, pick a few pilot products or some teams to start out with. If it doesn't work, it's easy to change to something else. Don't be afraid, and kind of like Reeny was referring to earlier, don't be afraid of something different. Just try it out and see how it goes, and you can always adapt. And then lastly, and this is a common thread that goes across everything, really leverage automation. I mean, it's obviously there for a reason, and without it, this becomes so much harder. And the key aspect of it is not just to automate it, but to get that feedback, get that alert, and get the notifications and everything in place so people know exactly what's happening. That's about it.
All right, so we're running a little bit late, but we have 5 minutes of the official time for Q&A, and then we'll be here as well.
Can you say a few words about
I'm sorry, there are mics there, so if you don't mind, going using them.
With putting new tools in place, one of the problems that I've run into with development teams is they're not really sure how to use the tools. What did you do to facilitate onboarding to those tools? Because developers, you know, they've come from someplace else, they're used to another tool, they'd want to use that, they don't want to take the time to learn something that isn't involved in writing code. How did you handle that?
So the central management and the team that we have in place was the team that actually worked very closely with the development organizations to handhold them, to make them understand how the tools work, to also do initially the triage of all the defects that come out. So as an example, when you look at static analysis tools, so let's pick Fortify. I'm sorry to pick on Fortify, but
that's a good one to pick on.
Yeah, you get tons of false positives in Fortify. And how do you actually go out and triage those false positives? So in our case, what has worked is really having that central expertise that we have extended to our security champions, and then training those champions along the way, because they are the ones who are all, at the end of the day, the torchbearers of security in their own organizations. So it's been a little bit of a partnership, but it's been a lot of triaging, training from the central team over to the champions.
So basically get your central team staffed up initially.
Absolutely.
And get them.
Right. And again, I don't claim that I have a huge central team. It's a small team. You start small with small product teams that small number of product teams, and then you kind of scale up.
Okay, thank you.
So I have two questions for you. You said that you did things to kind of bring people along with respect to your journey. Can you give me some examples of kinds of things in this transformation that you were able to do to kind of align in that direction? For example, did you have to train every developer on the agile methodology to align with that? Can you give me some examples of those?
Sure. So a couple of examples that I'll give. One is a business-focused example, and the other is more of the training type of example that you're talking about. So one is the entire notion of why we should really be paying attention to security, and why do we really care about security suddenly? Because as I mentioned, Autodesk has gone through a transformation. We've been a very desktop-focused, not caring much about security organization to where we are today. And what has helped is this entire sort of move to the cloud. Along with that came customer requirements and customer questions on, all right, so you want us to use your cloud products, what about security? So what has helped us is to take examples of what our customers are asking for and sort of demystify that for our developer organization, and then baking that into our training and awareness program. So we do the belt-based training, as I mentioned. There is obviously white belt is for everybody. Now there is a brown belt program where we actually take people through more sort of hands-on experience of how to do security, right? And how to actually use these tools and so on. So I think it's been a combination effort where we've spent a lot of time initially on raising awareness, but raising awareness not just for the sake of, hey, the central team is saying you should be doing security, but actually bringing in customer sort of reflection on what customer expectations are.
So the second question I have is, I didn't realize that you had so many products before this session, but given the existing investment and 150 plus products, which I'm assuming are non-cloud architecture earlier, and in this transformation, your experience, what would you say the code reuse of existing investment has taken place while you move to this new cloud architecture and microservices and so on in your experience?
So I missed the piece about what has been, what the...
So the existing investment in terms of code and products that you have, mm-hmm. right, when you move to cloud, were you able to leverage significant portion or is more of a ground up while keeping the same functionality into the new cloud architecture?
So I think we have experimented both ways, all right? So in some cases, we have tried to use the same. It hasn't worked, honestly. In some cases, we've had to go out and, completely change, because as you mentioned yourself, we are going from building these monolithic desktop apps, and now we are moving in the direction of using microservices in our cloud environment. So I wouldn't claim that we have been able to just do the transition very easily using the old architecture.
Yeah, hi. In your talk, I heard over and over again, the use of tools and the integration of tools, and these are perfect, absolutely. Yeah, I can't look at this process without looking at that. The piece that I didn't hear, and I'd like to hear you speak to, is in the arena of kind of the broader architectural frameworks and integration as it relates to both the multi-components of the product as well as the various cloud components. You did speak to configuration, and the bulk of that appeared to be operating system, but can you speak to that sort of broader segment that just doesn't fall well in the automation sort of side of things?
So you talked a little bit about threat modeling. I understand. Right. I mean, you covered that piece on that front, which is about when we do secure design analysis. Do you want to take
I can take a stab at it. So it's definitely not just about tools. We know that there has to be a lot of education and consulting, really. So we have this core team of security experts. And yes, they run the tools and they help with triaging and everything, but the other key aspect of it is of educating those advocates and educating the developers across of what they should be looking for, what they should be doing, so that we don't just become very tool reliant, because the tools are never going to find everything.
The other piece I'll add to this is, as an example, I'll tell you the types of products that we have. We know that cross-site scripting vulnerability is one of the biggest vulnerabilities that we face. How do we sort of use frameworks that may exist that will enable us to actually deal with that vulnerability at its root cause so that we use, so as an example, there's an OWASP framework that we have looked at and we have tried to bring that in and put it into the way we are building our products so that we are able to take care of, rather than going and fixing those point sort of providing point fixes to the cross-site scripting vulnerabilities, how do we eradicate it from the source? So we have been looking at those frameworks. We may not have done everything yet on that. There's still a lot more work that we continue to do and invest in.
Yeah, and I assumed when you said standards that that's what you were talking about, was turning that into standards, and then a great deal of that can be tested through automated tools and so on. But I guess my question to go back as sort of follow-up is, are you finding that scales well because of the tight teams with tight turnarounds and the continuous design that goes into that process?
So I would say the jury's still out. We have to wait and watch and see how that scales. So far, I think the appetite of our teams in going in the direction of standards was initially there was a lot of hesitation, and especially because of the nature of the company that we are working for, where, as I'd mentioned in passing, the fact that innovation is something which we say, hey, anyone can do anything the way they want it. That's the philosophy in which Autodesk has been traditionally been operating in. And now we are moving in the direction where we are saying, you must follow a standard, right? So it's taken us a while to get to that point. I think our executive management gets it very well, that that's the direction we want to be headed into. It's the down the ranks where we are still struggling a little bit. We still have flavors of things being done by different teams, different ways. But I think the message is going down very clear and clearly to them that for the sake of efficiency and scale, we will have to move in that direction.
One last question. It looks like you have a lot of reliance on a lot of open source components.
Who doesn't?
I guess in terms of patching cadence, right, that what do you see in your experience with respect to the amount of how much of patching you have to do, what is the frequency you have to kind of deal with all of these security vulnerabilities in all these third-party open source products?
So you're talking about our infrastructure side or our application?
Delivery and kind of to deal with that volume.
So on the infrastructure side, it's, again, going back to standardization. So what we have done is we have standardized on one flavor of Linux and one flavor of Windows. So our patching cadence is on those two flavors. And that's all we are going to do. Because, again, going back to, from a scale perspective, we cannot scale to secure every possible flavor that is out there. So that's the piece that we have been moving in the direction of. On the application side, we are still struggling a little bit because we have had a lot of legacy code with a lot of legacy open source, but all the new code that we are developing, we have realized that that's not the model in which we can operate. So it's easier on the newer side, which I think you will hear from anyone who's been in product security, more tough on the legacy side of the house. I'm sorry, you had a question. Okay. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you for being patient with us.
Thank you.